Good day to all the academic scholars, principals, teachers, and all of you who have an interest in educational leadership in the South Africa of 2021. I'm Kobus Mentz, professor in educational leadership at the Northwest University. I started my career as a high school mathematics teacher and later joined the Northwest University after pursuing further studies in educational leadership. It was a privilege to be co-author of a new IHOSIS publication in educational leadership titled Leadership Approaches to Negotiate Challenges in a Changing Education Landscape. It was an honor to work with two esteemed colleagues, namely Dr. Lientjie van Jaarsveld and Professor Charles Wolliter, in putting this publication together. The other colleagues who contributed to the chapters are Dr. Branwyn Challens, Dr. Ari van Wyk, Dr. Jan Kumalu, Dr. Chepu Tapala, Professor C.P. van der Vyver, Ms. Anadine Malan, and Dr. Dion Vos. Four of the contributors are former school principals who joined the Northwest University's Faculty of Education after successful careers in school management. We do believe that this publication is well grounded in scientific theory, but with very useful practical applications. From the side of the Northwest University, I would like to acknowledge the excellent professional cooperation from IHOSIS to put this book into the electronic space and on bookshelves. I will now focus on the main themes in the book. The title of Chapter 1 is Leadership as an Instrument to Address the Challenges Faced by South African Schools. Now, with education in South Africa viewed as an instrument to create the desired society, and it being in dire straits, as we know, leadership in education appears to be one factor that can help pull education out of its poor state. South Africa is no exception to the international pattern of placing uncapped faith in education. In fact, in the post-1994 socio-political reconstruction of the country, education has been assigned a pivotal role. In policy documents, and echoed in the political and public discourse in education too, a wide range of societal objectives of education can be detected. These objectives include the following: economic objectives, stamping out poverty, and being instrumental in the country's economic productivity and development. Societal objectives, bringing about a society where there is no racial, gender-based, or other forms of discrimination. Establishing a society that is socially mobile and dismantling artificial hierarchies and abstractions standing in the way of progress. The title of Chapter 2 is Contextual Factors and Leadership at Underperforming Schools. Poor achievement has been identified as one of the most pressing challenges facing South African schools. Whilst learner achievement levels vary considerably among South African schools, there is a block of schools that can be identified as severely underperforming schools. The root causes of such poor performance are manifold, but as research conducted amongst well-performing schools has indicated, leadership negotiating, contextual constraints and opportunities is the one factor that can make a difference. The aim of this research was to investigate leadership negotiating contextual factors in a sample comprising two underperforming schools in two provinces. The principals and four teachers in each school were interviewed. The findings were contrasted with the results of a similar exercise that had been conducted in the previous year in a sample comprising five top-achieving schools. The overall picture emanating from this research in poorly achieving schools is that teachers and principals are often oblivious as to the force of contextual factors impinging on their schools. This was obvious right from the first question, when some of the respondents could not appreciate the adverse effect of the cold weather on the learners. When the respondents from the Mpumalanga school were probed about the reasons for their poor matric results, they responded with answers around obviously irrelevant matters, such as that many learners were overaged up to 25 years of age. Further to that, the respondents tended to see themselves as victims and a mindset of defeatism. Despondence and the syndrome described by Martin Seligman in 1972 as self-helplessness was evident. In as far as the respondents were conscious of contextual factors impinging on the school, they had a rather singularly negative view of those and portrayed themselves in a passive role. They did not accept responsibility and, unlike the leaders at top-performing schools, did not respond innovatively in dealing with contextual impediments, much less turning these creatively into a force of strength. The authors of this chapter can make one suggestion in rectifying this sorry state of affairs. Recent retirees of top-performing schools could be contracted as consultants to poorly performing schools in order to develop and to drive, with the school leaders themselves, a turnaround strategy. In Chapter 4-3, we looked at moral leadership, an imperative for principals in underperforming schools. Now, as we know, principals have to create and maintain a positive climate within their schools, and sound relationships amongst people are the central points of the work of school leaders. As such, school leadership must be a moral activity in its nature and focus. Effective school leadership is seen as a key factor to improve school effectiveness. The exercising of authority and power always involves ethical challenges, and this internal system of moral values in every individual necessitates the inclusion of morality in any leadership concept that presupposes a dual relationship between leaders and followers. Leadership is a moral task, and school leaders and staff create caring and respectful behavior. The school principal is the main role player in the school. The school environment is to a large extent created by the principal, and it is the moral feeling that is derived from the values the principal professes and brings into being. The findings of this research paint a bleak picture of the moral position amongst the principals and teachers in these underperforming schools. The relationships amongst the different role players are poor, and the levels of respect are low. They do not trust one another. The staff do not support the learners enough. They do not support one another enough. The level of care is low, and they do not do enough to strengthen moral values in their schools. In Chapter 4, we looked at the influence of school principals' leadership on the school climate in underperforming schools. There are several reasons why some schools do not perform well. Poor infrastructure, a lack of resources, poor socioeconomic conditions, poverty, and a lack of discipline, amongst other things, are stated as reasons. However, many schools do perform well under unfavorable conditions. And this raises the question, to what extent does the school principal's leadership play a role in the performance of a school? In addition, school climate is mentioned in this chapter, and school climate is often associated with achievement. Whether the leadership of the school principal plays a role in creating an environment in the school that is conducive to learning and performance is also under discussion. It is well known that learners perform well in a healthy environment where effective teaching and learning can take place. When leadership, school climate, and learner performance are mentioned together, a well-performing school seems to be associated with a strong leadership from the principal, a combination of leadership styles, and a healthy school climate. The focus in Chapter 5 was on the principal's leading role during change in schools towards sustainable improvement in disadvantaged settings. A factor that has consistently been identified in the literature as being critical for managing change and mitigating the underperformance of learners is effective leadership. The research question in this chapter was to determine how principals can lead change in schools towards sustainable improvement in disadvantaged settings. A qualitative research design combined with an interpretive orientation was followed to interview 5 principals of schools situated in poor communities individually and to conduct focus group interviews at their respective schools. In Chapter 6, the focus was on school leadership, school climate, and academic performance. And this was the result of a study conducted in the KwaZulu-Natal province in South Africa. Practices such as threats, victimization, attacks, harassment, and bullying are obstacles in the way of effective education. The South African reality begs for a solution, and questions regarding leadership in schools, the school climate, and the effect thereof on learner performance come to the fore. The aim of the quantitative research in this chapter was to explore and understand the importance of school climate as an indicator of learner performance, as well as the role of school leaders to ensure a positive school climate. The study has focused on the relationship between principals' leadership styles and the school climate in order to enhance academic performance. Engaged and effective teachers are, as well as quality teaching and learning, are the results of an appropriate leadership style and a healthy school climate. This leads to the achievement of individual and collective objectives, namely sustainable or improved academic performance. The title of Chapter 7 is School Principal Leadership in the 21st Century. When schools are discussed, the role of the principal is often scrutinized. The role of the principals has changed significantly over time. The principal's role is not only that of a planner, organizer, leader, and person in control, but has also expanded to keep up with entrepreneurship, the fourth industrial revolution, and the management of millennial teachers. Yes, teachers, not only students. Furthermore, principals have to deal with violence in and around the school. The principal of today requires exceptional qualities to handle many issues while still executing the routine day-to-day tasks. The emphasis in this chapter falls on effective leadership in schools. The purpose of this research was to determine how principals still succeed in effective and successful leadership despite the intricate issues experienced at present. And interviews were conducted with 10 principals in 7 provinces. In this study, it can be deducted that leadership is a compilation of factors. The leader's personality must be kept in mind. An individual's personality will determine if he or she will be the best principal in a particular context. The innate features may possibly lead the leader to be a successful leader in various contexts. In Chapter 8, the focus was on a model for the induction of deputy principals in diverse school contexts. Now, the objective of this chapter was to develop a model that can be utilized for inducting deputy principals in diverse South African schools. There is a notable paucity of empirical research focusing specifically on the induction of deputy principals. So far, very little attention has been paid to the role of the induction in the socialization of deputy principals. This chapter is based on a quantitative survey design study that sought to identify the induction needs of deputy principals. And it focuses on problems they experience and the skills they need. And then eventually a model was recommended for their induction. The induction model that is unpacked in this chapter postulates that the induction of new deputy principals should be thought about even before deputy principals are appointed. If the employer appoints suitably qualified, experienced, and competent deputy principals, the induction process will undoubtedly proceed in a very smooth way. The argument that the pre-service phase is part of induction stems from the fact that deputy principals are recruited, selected, and eventually appointed during this phase. In Chapter 9, the need for curriculum leadership training programs for members of school management teams was discussed. The literature review reveals that there is a great need for school management teams to be trained in what they are doing and in leading their schools for successful curriculum implementation. It is with this in mind that this research undertook to explore the need for curriculum leadership training programs for school management teams. During the research, a qualitative phenomenological approach underpinned by an interpretive paradigm was followed. The participants in this research were members of school management teams, namely principals, deputy principals, and heads of departments. Data were also collected through field notes and audio recording devices. School management team members are the drivers of curriculum delivery in schools and the entire schooling system, actually. Their importance cannot be underestimated. School management teams can make or break learners' performance. For them to be able to carry out their work effectively and efficiently, they need to be trained and developed. It is, however, important to note that in most countries, school management team members are not well trained to perform their curriculum leadership roles they are expected to fulfill. This research therefore explored the need for curriculum leadership training programs for school management teams in schools, with the aim of preparing and improving the curriculum leadership roles of school management teams. In Chapter 10, we address the management of schools with the use of information and communications technology, and especially the needs of rural and township school principals. Now, schools, just as other organizations, have experienced many changes with regard to the use and availability of technology. The introduction of ICTs in schools has had a significant impact on the roles and responsibilities of school leaders. School leaders should keep abreast of new technologies and use these technologies to their advantage in the management of the school. It is not known whether school leaders are equipped with the necessary knowledge and skills to apply ICTs in the management of schools. This research therefore aimed to find out what needs rural and township school principals have with regard to training in the use and implementation of ICTs in the management of their schools. In this research, it crystallized that the implementation process regarding utilizing ICT in school management and the deliverance of the white paper on e-learning are taking place at a slower pace than was initially intended. The effect of the lack of use of ICT in schools is that school leaders of rural and township schools become more and more technologically handicapped in the fast-changing world of technology. Not being ICT literate can be frustrating to a school leader and can affect his or her management skills negatively, in the end also influencing the school negatively. Training institutions and the National Department of Education could address these training needs in specific programs designed for school leadership. And in Chapter 11, looked at the influence of local school governance structures on creating an opportunity for the establishment of a positive school climate. Now, school climate refers to the experience of the prevailing atmosphere in the school by the teachers and the learners. This school climate is influenced by various factors. Examples of these factors are the morale of teachers, the management style of the principal, and the influence of the SGB on the general control of the school to establish a positive school climate. Four performing schools were identified in Gauteng and the Western Cape to determine the involvement and effectiveness of the SGB, school governing body, in the overall governance of the school, with a view to establish a positive school climate. From the findings, it was observed that all of these performing schools in the study population had extremely functional and effective school governing bodies. Mutual support, respect, and trust between the school governing body, school management, and the rest of the staff were highlighted by the participants. In chapter 12, we closed by looking at the leadership and the challenges faced by South African schools in a changing world. Now, this chapter summarized the book. It summarized, it synthesized, and reflected on the chapters making up this book. It is clear from the selection of chapters comprising the book, firstly, that leadership in schools is significant, both in its own right and serving as a fulcrum to successfully negotiate many other challenges, such as debilitating contextual factors. Secondly, leadership is complex. The borders of educational leadership cannot be drawn at the walls of the principal's office. Educational leadership entails and is affected by much more than what takes place in the office of the principal. Thank you. Thank you.